and welcome to Fund Manager Fridays with 5 Paisa. I am Deepika Asthana, your host for the evening. We're all different people with different requirements and income levels. But most of us have one goal in common, and that is to create wealth. Log anek par goal ek. Lekin kya aapko pata hai ki wealth kaise create kar sakte hain? Joining us today to answer this very fundamental question is Aditi Kothari, Vice Chairperson and Head of Sales, Marketing and E-Business at DSP Investment Managers Private Limited. She also serves as a member of the Executive Committee. Aditi is passionate about financial education and guiding investors in the right way, and has set up several initiatives that aim to ensure that the full benefits of investing can accrue to all members of the population, especially to the female members of the society. Welcome, Aditi. It is indeed a pleasure to host you.
Thank you, Deepika. Really happy to be on the show. And as I always passionate to increase education in, you know, all kinds of investors and possible investors.
Perfect. So then I'm going to keep this very simple, Aditi, because that's exactly what investment should be like. So if I'm a young individual, which I am, who has big plans for life, what are the top 5 things that you will tell me that can help me on my wealth creation journey?
Okay, so I would start with starting early. Very important to know that the earlier you start, the more ups and downs of the market you can survive, or rather the downs that you can survive. So if I start at, you know, age 5, I have hopefully another, you know, 80 years to go. Mm-hmm. So even if there are some downs, I can make them up with all the ups. So my point is that you can take risk if you start early. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have seen that equity markets over the long run always do well, but it's never a straight line.
Right.
And so you would be able to stomach that much more when you're 5 years old. When you're 70 years old and you start your investment journey and the market goes down, mm-hmm. I don't know how many years you have to mm-hmm. be able to sustain down and then up and really enjoy that money after that. Sure. Frankly, why are we making the money? Eventually is to enjoy our life. So actually at 70, you should be enjoying life and, you know, enjoying the money that you've made over all these years because you started at the age of 5.
Mm-hmm. I agree, actually. 70 is the age to enjoy the fruits of your labor rather than start sowing seeds.
One more thing to add there. Mm-hmm. One more reason to start early is called compounding. So, you know, if you start today, you, 1 rupee, say your money compounds. Typically, you can say at a 7% rate, your money will compound every 10 years, or your will double every 10 years.
Okay.
So you will have, if you start at 5, you will have at least 7 to 8, 10 year periods for your money to double.
All right. Okay.
Right. Because money makes money and interest makes. So you have your principal, you make interest on that. Then on the total, again, you make interest. So you make interest on your interest and your interest. Mm-hmm. So it just goes on. Compounding is what that is called. Mm-hmm. And the earlier you start, the more periods you have for that compounding. So anyone who has children, start their investments today in their name.
That's interesting, actually, especially if we can spend a little bit more time on compounding, because you know what you mentioned about how money doubles every 5 years, right?
So if seven.
Every 7 years, right?
Every 10 years, if it's at a 7% interest, which is an average return that I'm taking, that we have seen in the Indian market over time.
Okay, so then I'm just going to repeat this so that there is no confusion. The benefit of compounding is this, that if you're growing your money at the rate of 7%, which is the average rate you can expect from an equity investment, then your money is likely to double every 10 years.
Yes. So there's something called the rule of 72.
Okay.
Write this down. Very important. You take 72, divide by the rate of return that you expect.
Okay.
That gives you the number of years that your money will double in. So 72 divided by 7 gives you 10, roughly 10. So every 10 years your money will double. If by chance we get lucky and over those 10 years period, you know, and we get a return say of 10%, then every 7 years it can double. If I'm really lucky and I get 12% return on my total portfolio, it can be a portfolio of equity, debt, everything mixed. Say I get a 12% return. And 72 divided by 12 is 6. So your money is doubling every 6 years. But I'm being conservative and taking in 7%. So that, you know, you can say that it doubles every 10 years. So 7% is what people should aim at. And anything above that is a bonus.
Okay. So perfect. I think it's best to be conservative, like you mentioned. And so from what you've just explained to us, since it doubles every 10 years, and let's assume we start investing at the age of 10, right? And then we invest, let's say, till the age of 60. So 6 times over, this is going to double.
Yeah.
Right? Which is, I think, if we really had to calculate the returns, it would be fair to say that the returns would be exponential over this entire period of time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Perfect. 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 Super. Let's move on to the next one then.
So one is start early. Two is don't invest your money. If you're a beginner, don't invest it all at once. That is something called an SIP, which is a systematic investment plan. Invest it in small proportions. And what you do is you can automate your investments. That means every month I want X amount invested. You can even do what is called a top-up SIP. Because over time in life, your salary will also go up. Hopefully, it will, of course.
Yes.
And so every year, you can say, I want to top up. Means I can top it up by 10%. So every month, say, I'm putting 25,000 rupees. And then, you know, it keeps topping up. So next year will be 30, year after that, maybe 40 every month. The rule really is the 50-30-20 rule. 50% of your salary normally goes in all your expenses, right? Home expenses, etc. 30% you should keep for entertainment. No one is saying don't have a good time. Have a blast. And 20%, be disciplined about that saving, which should go into an SIP. If you're doing equity fund, you can even do fixed income, but it's just the discipline that it gives you. Every month on a certain date, that money is going to be invested, no matter what. And you know what? Whether the market goes up and down, commit to that investment. In fact, when it's down, it's the best thing for you. Don't stop your SIP. Because when it's down, you're collecting more units. Means you're almost buying in a sale. When the market is down, at low prices, you're buying. So don't stop your SIP when the market goes down, and just let it continue. Keep the discipline. You'll be surprised what you'll find in 20 years.
Wow, that's interesting. And correct me if I'm wrong, but one of the very good things about SIPs in India, at least, is that you don't need to start very big. I think you can start an SIP with as little as 500 rupees monthly.
Yes.
So from
you can
that,
do it. You can easily do it at 500. So, you know, that is, don't feel like I need to jump in into something very big. But 500 is small. I mean, of course, make it as a proportion of what you have, what you earn. And just make it a discipline in life. That's all.
Yeah. So basically follow your 50-30-20 rule that you mentioned, right?
Yes. So right now we've learned the rule of 72.
Yes.
We've learned the rule of 50-30-20. I promise I won't give too many more numbers.
No, it's good, right? Because, you know, Aditi, what happens is that people say a lot of things, right? But if we have the ability to break it down into numbers and see it very clearly, अच्छा लगता है, right? Like somebody recently said, I think whenever you start an investment, the first question anybody asks is कितना मिलेगा, right? So by doing all of these things, you have a fair idea. There is no promise, and but you have a fair idea ki kitna mil sakta hai aapko. And that itself is the biggest incentive to continue investing, right? Just one more thing I wanted to discuss a little bit in detail with you, Aditi, is that you mentioned the whole idea of rupee cost averaging and why in market lows is the time where you must continue with your SIPs. And that is, I think, something which we have historically noticed, that many, many investors, that the moment the markets fall, they stop their SIP. Right? So a little bit more on why it's important actually to continue staying invested and how rupee cost averaging is one of the main reasons why you start an SIP.
So what happens is that people panic when the market goes down. Investing is not about, I went to an MBA school and fancy, you know, sort of IIM or Harvard or whatever. It has nothing. The people who went there could be also the worst investors. It's about your emotions. And you need to be able to control your emotions when things go down. And we're all human. We panic when the market goes down. We want to stop everything. And this, if you just let it be, because if you have to make a decision to invest when the market goes down, because everyone's saying, "Arey, it's so cheap now, you should be investing," you won't do it because you're scared. But if you automatically do it, you know, then automatically it's going, you're making an emotionless decision. An automated rule is making a decision for you. That is very important in investing. Now, rupee cost averaging means that I don't know if the market's going to go up tomorrow or down tomorrow. I never know. JP Morgan had a very famous saying when someone asked him, "What do you think the markets will do tomorrow?" "What do you think the market will do tomorrow?" So he thought, he contemplated, he really, you know, there was something macro going on. Thought. He said, "It will fluctuate." That is the only truth of markets. They will fluctuate. So whether it is going down or whether it is going up, it is better that you do an SIP so that you average your incoming cost. We are not someone who can really time the market. Don't even try. If you have the guts and the market really falls, please put in a lump of money. No one is saying no, but I want to know how many people put in the money on 23rd March and put in lumpy money then. Which is when the market recently went low. Your emotions and your gut doesn't allow you to do it. You freeze, you get paralysis. So we want to avoid all that. And that's why a SIP is the right way to go.
Perfect. So it will help you overcome the emotional biases, which are inherent in human nature. And also, I think what you said about the volatility aspect, the only thing really sure about the market is that it's volatile. And then SIP is the best way to ride those waves, the peaks and troughs of the market.
It is the only truth of the market.
Superb. Great. So moving on to the next big tenet.
I would say there is something called risk profiling. Please make sure that you fill in a questionnaire where risk profiling is concerned. Now, I am going to explain this. Okay. Think of it as a triangle. Okay. At one point, you have what is taking called risk-taking ability. You should know your risk-taking ability, which means your age. Am I very young? Do I have any dependence on me? You know, if both those questions, if I'm young and I don't have any dependence and I'm earning some good money, of course I can take risks. So your ability to take risk is high. You know, you don't mind in the short run if the market goes down. You know, because your ability to take risk is there. You're going to live, you're 25 years old, you're going to live till 80. Arey, take some risk. It's okay. If you're 80 years old and you're living on a pension and you say, "I want to take risk and put all my money in the most riskiest security in the equity market," sorry, you don't have, you can't take. Your ability is not there to take the risk, even if you want to take the risk. So let's assess your ability first. Understand your ability to take the risk. Second of all, what is your risk tolerance? Risk tolerance is, am I okay that if I invest the money today and tomorrow the market is down 20-30%, will I freak out? Will I get anxious? Will I start sweating? Am I okay with that? Because I know within, I'm too in for the long run. I'm in for 10-20 years, maybe 30 years. So the market will go up. Array, these small things happen. then your risk tolerance is very high. Some person says, no way, it's my first time in my markets, and you know, my spouse will kill me or my father will kill me. You know, I will panic if the market goes down 20-30%. Like, I will go crazy. I cannot tolerate the market going down. Okay, so your risk tolerance is lower.
Okay.
The third thing here is a goal. So then what is your goal? My goal is to amass enough wealth to give to my children. Okay, fine. But guess what? I don't want to take any risk. I cannot stand the market going down 10%. Do you earn money? Yeah, my ability to take risk is high. I only have one child. I'm earning good money. So then you need an outside person, a good financial advisor, to tell you, hey, you know, you got to take more risk. You got to be pushy. Because if your goal is to give it to your children, you are going to live another 40, 50 years, and then you want to give it to your children. So you can't take the risk because it's long term. So I'll push you for your risk tolerance a little bit at least. Okay, if my goal is to buy a house in 3 years and I want to go crazy and all the money I want to buy for the house, I want to put into the market so that I can buy a bigger house. That is my aim. You can't afford that, because if your goal is in 3 years to get a house, you can't risk it all in the market today. So even if your tolerance is high, I don't mind if the market goes down, it'll go up. In 3 years, it may not go up. So you need someone to balance those things for you. Okay, maybe I'm a 80-year-old, let's like, you know, an 80-year-old person who is risk tolerance is very high. I'm okay to bungee jump. I want to go bungee jumping. I'm 80 years old. I'm fit, yeah, I'm 80 years old, but I want to go bungee jumping. But your ability is low. You can't bungee jump at 80. I will not allow you to do that.
Correct, correct.
So we need to balance all these three. And so something that's right for me may not be right for you. So don't try to take the tip from your friend. Isme dal do na. But you don't know my goals. You don't know my ability. You don't know my tolerance. So don't take tips. You have to balance them all, and therefore stay accountable to yourself. Someone tells you isme dal do and you did it, and then you blame that friend. But A, that friend should not have told you that, but B, you should not have listened, because you are different than that person. So this is something very important for everyone to understand. Please understand yourself, understand your risk tolerance and your risk-taking ability. Goal, of course, is one other thing that you need to balance. But the bottom, the first two that I said are the most important for you to understand.
So Aditi, what you've just said, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but my biggest message right now has been that then the time, the investment, and it goes back to your first point about starting early, that if you have a longer time frame, you can take more risk also, and accordingly maybe, you know, reach your goals. If your goals are more short term in nature, irrespective of your income levels and your ability, it is best advice not to take on too much risk, because they are very near, and if they are far, far off into the future, then definitely you can take on more risk, even if your ability or income levels might not be that high. Is that accurate?
Well, the second part that you said is that you're saying that you can take on risk if you're young, is what you said. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So basically, if you're young and you have a long time frame for like investment time frame, your ability to ride the market ups and downs is better than somebody whose investment time frame is not very long. So even if, like, for example, a 25-year-old person, I want to buy a house in 5 years' time. So as a 25-year-old who has a good income, I can definitely take on decent amount of risk. Lekin because my horizon is only 5 years, ki 5 saal mein mujhe ghar lena hai, I can't put all my money into equities there. So
you're very right. You have to balance it all. You must balance it all. So even if your ability is right, but you have a goal which is only 5 years, then you have to be more conservative than when I have told you your goal is, you know, 15 years away. So definitely, and you can have many goals. Mm-hmm. So X is left for my house. So mm-hmm. my risk taking ability is low in that. Mm-hmm. I mean, and my risk tolerance should be low in that. Mm-hmm. But if I have X amount left for retirement and I'm going to retire at 60, mm-hmm. 70, then that part, that goal, you can take higher risk.
Perfect. Superb. So we're, I think we're done with three. We're down to the penultimate, the fourth tenet.
Yeah. So the other, I would say, is, you know, asset allocation is very mm-hmm. important. And please know that you can't put all your eggs in one basket. Mm. Okay. You can't have all your money in FDs and then expect to meet your goals. You can't have all your money fixed income mm-hmm. debt, which is debt funds, which are, you know, less risky, not mm-hmm. as volatile. Mm-hmm. But then your return also will be low. Mm-hmm. You can't have everything in equities for the reasons I just told you.
Right.
Because
right.
equity markets fluctuate. Suddenly, if you need the money, what if you have an emergency? What if you suddenly need the money? Even if you tell me your horizon is, you know, 20, mm-hmm. 30 years. Mm-hmm. And by the way, everyone should have an emergency corpus, which is just put in liquid funds.
Okay.
But what if we need even more than that, right? Mm-hmm. So I would say you must have a good asset allocation. Have 50% in, I'm not saying 50%, have a balance of debt and equity according to what your risk profile is and your risk tolerance is.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Most importantly, if you're more conservative and you can't stand the volatility of the market, then you're going to have much more mm-hmm. fixed income so that mm-hmm. your portfolio doesn't move too much up and down. If you have more tolerance and you're okay, you have a long-term horizon, you take more equity. Mm. But please don't put everything only in one instrument. Mm. And if that goes bad, you will just say mutual funds are bad. Investing is not for me.
Correct.
Why blame investments when there is a right way to do it, but you haven't learned it? So very important, do your homework, find out yourself, please take the time to do risk profiling, mm-hmm. talk to an advisor. All are these things that, you know, mm-hmm. I would tell you to do. Start early.
Okay, perfect. So I think, you know, that asset allocation bit, in my view, ties up the whole package, right? That look at your risk, start early, and then allocate your investments across different assets for the reasons that you just highlighted, right? Like you want to reach your goal also, you want to keep it within your risk parameters also. So for that, it's very important that you have a mix of assets, and every asset brings something unique to the table or offers something unique. Within that, if possible, can you just highlight maybe for our listeners, two, three aspects that they must take into consideration when creating an asset allocation strategy? Of course, best done with a financial advisor, but always good to know as well.
Again, it comes down to risk profiling.
Okay.
I mean, I can't stress more on that. Mm-hmm. There is no other way to do asset allocation rather than mm-hmm. risk profiling. Your circumstance is going to be different than my circumstance.
Perfect.
So mm-hmm. the only thing I would say is, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Don't mm-hmm. put everything in equities. Don't put everything in direct stocks. Don't put everything in just fixed income mutual funds. Don't put everything in FDs. Please do a bit of all. Okay. And frankly, direct stocks, if you're, it's great fun to play around with. Okay. Mm-hmm. Keep your fun money in that, because they're the most volatile of them all. And especially if you are not an analyst and cannot, you know, read balance sheets and fixed and income statements, maybe that is something that you should be doing. But talk to an advisor, yes. Do your research before you do that.
Perfect. That sounds good. And of course, everybody's asset allocation plan is unique because we are all individuals. So don't follow your friend or partner or colleague's asset allocation plan. Create one for yourself with your financial advisor. Perfect. So I think that brings us to our last tenet for wealth creation.
I think I've covered almost everything because I combined a few. Mm-hmm. But is there anything that you'd want me to talk about more specifically that you maybe had in mind?
So I think a little bit, Aditi, we can talk about financial education and how it's important to empower yourself with not just the right advice, but yourself do a little bit of homework, learn, upskill. It'll help you make the best decisions. So we can talk about
So
that.
that's what I actually had even said that for the direct stocks, especially, please do your homework. Even if you're investing in mutual funds, do your homework for sure.
I'm just going to take a minute to summarize my top key takeaways from this wonderful conversation. So we started with how do we create wealth, and there are some very simple ways that if which as individuals we all follow, we will definitely be on the right path to wealth creation. So the first one is of course the rule of 72, which Aditi introduced, starting with the fact that investments you should start as early as possible. Applying the rule of 72 basically says that if you take 72 and divide it by the returns that you expect to generate from an investment, you will know how fast your money will double. So, for example, if you're expecting a 7% return, then every 10 years your money is expected to double. Then we moved on to the importance of systematic investment plans, and more specifically, why it is important to automate your investments. It removes the inherent human bias in investment decision making, and it also helps you take advantage of market ups and downs, thereby ensuring that you don't run off from the market when the opportunities are the best. Then we also spoke about the importance of risk profiling, and I genuinely feel, and you've stressed on that as well, that your risk profile and your risk tolerance is really one of the biggest factors that can help you make the best investment decisions. Know how much risk you can take, consult an advisor, use many of these online forms that are available to assess your risk tolerance. Then we moved on to asset allocation. Again, do not put all your investments in one basket. Every investment has ups and downs. If you spread it across multiple asset classes, you can benefit. Like debt offers stability, equity offers returns. So if you mix it, you can benefit from each asset class and potentially grow wealth over the long term and meet your goals. And then at the end, we summed it up with the fact that you must do your homework, especially if you're doing investing in direct stocks, but otherwise as well. You can only be truly empowered if you understand what you're investing in. So those are my top five key takeaways. But Aditi, any last words? You just covered everything so well, but anything else that you would like to say?
Take charge, start early, get an advisor if you're not confident, and just don't stop your SIPs if you have one.
Perfect. On that note, thank you, Aditi, for joining us today, and thank you, listeners, for tuning in. Until next time. Thank you.
Investments in securities market are subject to market risks. Read all the related documents carefully before investing.